So, has everyone had a productive morning? Yes? Yes. I think we certainly have been inspired. But we are in for a treat now. It is truly my pleasure, even though he just introduced himself, to reintroduce today's keynote speaker, David Johns, Executive Director of the White House Initiative on Educational Excellence for African Americans. In this important role, Mr. Johns works to identify evidence-based best practices to improve African American student achievement from cradle to career. The initiative works across federal agencies and with partners and communities nationwide to produce a more effective continuum of education programs for African American students. Prior to serving in this role, Mr. Johns was a senior education policy advisor to the Senate Committee on Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions. He also was a Congressional Black Caucus Foundation Fellow and has worked on issues affecting low-income and minority students, neglected youth and early childhood initiatives, and historically black colleges and universities. His research as an Andrew W. Mellon Fellow served as a catalyst to identify, disrupt, and supplant negative perceptions of black males both within academia and society. I remember, and I think it's been over a year ago, when a key staff member, Elizabeth Trotman, I believe, met Mr. Johns in Cincinnati, and she came back and she said, "Janet, we absolutely must find the right opportunity to bring him to Columbus." So please welcome David Johns.
Thank you for that. I appreciate that. My pleasure. So first, let me say thank you for having me back in Columbus. It was maybe 6-7 months ago when I was here visiting with my brothers from the program, and have also enjoyed spending quite a bit of time with the Urban League of Greater Columbus. So first, let me just say thank you to all of you who have gathered here today and those of you who are not in this room who do phenomenal work on behalf of our children, our communities, and our country. Before I start, I want to get the most important business out of the way. All of the students, the scholars, will you please stand? Yep, you guys stand again. And then I know there's some other younger brothers I saw. Yep, you too. Yep, you. Yep. I'm talking about you. Y'all stand up. Yep, you. All of the students. Little beautiful black baby in the back. He can't stand by himself, but it's worthy of love. Sir, stay standing. I'm not finished yet. So on behalf of President Barack Obama, our fabulous First Lady Michelle Obama, and the U.S. Secretary of Education, Arne Duncan, hear me when I say that I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you for showing up every day and for defying the odds. I'm proud of you for not believing the lies that the world may have you believing about yourself. I'm proud of you for knowing that you are beautiful and you are brilliant and that you're not only obligated to go to college, but to graduate, right? 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 All right, y'all have a seat. So for those who don't know or who are recently introduced to our work, I have the pleasure of serving as the first ever director of the White House Initiative on Educational Excellence for African Americans. The abbreviated title is the White House Initiative on Educational Excellence for African Americans. Why? Because far too often you don't hear those words strung together, right? Unless we come to a conference like this where the express goal is to try and find solutions for the problems that many people can recite, sometimes factually inaccurate, but cite nonetheless. We were established by President Obama, the only initiative to be established by President Obama. So the next time somebody says the black president hasn't done anything for black people, you can cite my executive order as a receipt, evidence, right? And we are now one of six similarly situated initiatives that focus on filling population-specific gaps. So the eldest initiative is the White House Initiative on Historically Black Colleges and Universities, established under Carter. There are also similar White House initiatives on educational excellence for Hispanics, Asian American Pacific Islanders, Native Americans, Alaska Natives, and Native Hawaiians, as well as one focused on filling faith-based and neighborhood partnerships. And again, those all existed before President Obama took office. And so in doing an assessment of opportunities to, again, improve the lives of children, to support our communities, and to strengthen this country, the president signed our executive order to ensure that there was an intentional and unapologetic office focused on leveraging all federal resources to close opportunity gaps. And so what I want to do today is really talk about a couple of the lessons that we've learned that have really been important. I want to be clear that nothing I'm going to say is going to be a shock or a surprise to anybody. In fact, I had the pleasure of sitting, listening to the first two panels, and I'm going to reiterate a lot of the things that the experts have already been highlighting, which are things that you all know, right? I want to acknowledge that we're having a conversation with the congregation, so I'm hopeful that at a minimum you'll find things that you can help share with others. Before I start with this presentation that I'm going to use to assist me, I'm going to ask that you guys join me in saying thank you to one of your leaders in this community, but who supports my work, Tykea Wright, who owns a consulting firm here, who's also a champion for all students. Has been appointed by President Obama to serve on our President's Advisory Commission, and so she is doing the work of helping to ensure that the things that are happening here are connected federally. So I would just ask on her behalf, on her behalf, that you guys continue to cover her as she does that work. Can you all do that? Awesome. So let's be clear, and this should come as, again, no surprise, as what I did with my brothers is what I do always, that I, as Brother Asa Hilliard said, have never met a child who was not a genius. And I want to be especially clear that I have never met a child of color, a poor child, a child who we now celebrate as being resilient or demonstrating grit, who was not a genius. And as Asa said, there's no secret to how we support them. The first thing we do is to acknowledge that they are human. And the second thing we do is to support them with love. Can you play the video?
Because of the three doctors, we can be our brother's keeper, stay focused, and work to succeed together.
If your heart's not smiling right now, then something is wrong with you. This video is a part of a campaign called Because of Them, becauseofthem.com, and what Unique has done is take our babies, right, little brothers who look like some of these young brothers right here, and cast them in the images of our leaders who we sometimes only celebrate in February, right? And she did it in a way that I think is powerful because it reminds us all that all of our children, I call them babies, no disrespect to when they decide that they are grown, but that all of our babies are deserving of the love and protection that we sometimes only give to literal babies, right? And the reality is that in spite of the way that they may show up physically or otherwise, our babies in particular, boys and men of color, black boys, need the same love, protection, affirmation, you heard him when he said it, and support as everybody else needs. And so the reality is that all of our babies are born with untapped potential, but we live in a world where, as the president and secretary have said, too often a child's access to opportunity and success is determined by code, predetermined by code to be sure. What I'm saying is that if you give me a map of the state of Ohio or of almost any other state throughout this country, and I have a few identifying factors, zip code or genetic code, we can almost map out life trajectories with some exceptions. And in a world where this country has innovated in so many fields and industries, the fact that this is still a reality is a problem. The fact that there are so many children who are perceived as being problems before they're ever acknowledged as people is something that we have the power to change. And so I want to be plain for those of you who have not been in a classroom recently, who have not been able to sit with Dr. Durant or some of the other superintendents who do this work, right? That this is the reality for too many of our babies. When asked what they want to be when they grow up, the question is simply a lie, right? But again, what we should be focusing on is not the exceptional moments in which we as adults fail our children, but the fact that we can do work to support all of them. This is Thessalonica, a young lady who graduated at the age of 16, not only with a high school diploma, but with an AA degree, right? We're going to talk a little bit about it in the panel discussion, but her superintendent leveraged dual enrollment programs and her mother had enough sense and support to put her in a program, right? When I was young, it was that I was loquacious. That's what the teacher said when they were trying to be nice. I asked a lot of questions. Y'all keep asking questions, right? But instead of just having her in a space where she might have otherwise been causing trouble, suspended or expelled, which happens to kids of color at rates that don't happen to their non-African-American counterparts or Latino counterparts or disabled counterparts, her energy was directed in ways that are now channeled and have allowed her to achieve a level of success. Mosiah Bridges, Mose Bowles. Mose was sitting in class yesterday on Friday making more money than some of us in this room. He runs a company called Mose Bowles, right? One of the most arturally sophisticated young men you'll ever meet. He made the pocket square that I'm wearing right now. Yes, I know it looks nice, right? Michaela is the youngest person ever to be carried in Whole Foods. Runs a company called Be Sweet Lemonade. Makes lemonade using her grandmother's flaxseed oil recipe and takes a portion of her proceeds and donates it to the conservation of bees. She runs this company in Texas. Yep, Texas. Think about two things for a second. One, what does it mean for young children, black, white, and otherwise, to walk through a Whole Foods in the middle of Texas and see her beautiful brown face hanging from the rafters? It forces us to have a different conversation about the diversity that exists in our country that sometimes makes adults uncomfortable to discuss. The second thing is this. I encounter far too many kids that when I ask them, if you know a STEM professional, they draw a blank. Why? Because they're trying to imagine a white man on a bench doing lab work. And the reality is that both Mosiah and Michaela are STEM entrepreneurs. Leveraging tools that were cultivated by people that didn't even have the degrees or credentials that we now celebrate formally. This is powerful for kids who grow up in a world where they are told often that they can't, shouldn't, or won't. But I'm doing this to remind you that they are all capable and deserving of our support. These are my brothers, Joshua and Jeremiah. They wrote a book called Champions of Change. And as they say in their words, the book is designed to talk about saving, spending, and sharing. They talk about the importance of young people understanding their financial economies. Some of y'all are still trying to figure out financial literacy. They got it down and wrote a book. Joshua, the younger of the two, the one on the your right, my left, ended up saying, you know what? After they wrote this book, the kids should be able to write their own books as well. So if you go to buy this book now on Amazon, if you flip it, you'll get 2-in-1. There's another book that allows kids to create their own stories. Babies who are making change happen. And the sad reality is that sometimes we have these moments where we celebrate them as exceptions when they are all the rule. And the problem is that we don't acknowledge that when there are exceptions, when our babies fall through the cracks, when they're not supported in the ways in which all of us need to be supported, that it's our fault. No such thing as problem kids. I've never met a problem kid in my life. I've met kids who've been failed by systems and adults who were sensitive enough to respond to it. But what I'm saying is that we all have a role to play in supporting the cognitive, social, and emotional development of all of our babies. So let me pause for a second. How many educators are in the room? Please stand. Please stand. I'm asking everybody to celebrate you for doing God's work. I ain't say sit down yet. How often do you guys get to be celebrated for doing that with your purpose to do? Hear me when I say thank you. I know, having been in the classroom myself, that the most worthy thing that you can do that you could expend your energy on is supporting our children. And so on behalf of all of those lives you touch and the people who don't say thank you enough, hear me when I say thank you. Please take a seat. So I want to be clear in saying again that there are no lay people in this. I highlighted educators because sometimes people say silly things like teaching isn't rocket science. You're right, it's a lot harder. So while everyone should consider whether or not there's a calling on their life as an educator, let's be clear, everybody has a role to play, right? This is not an us versus them thing. The first question that everybody needs to ask is, are we worthy of our children? Write it down, tweet it, pray on it. Are we worthy of our children? The next thing is then for you to demonstrate what that looks like, right? Second question, when you look at our babies, in particular, given the topic of today, when you look at black and brown men and boys, do you see them as people before you perceive them as problems. Again, this is not a black-white thing. I've heard some of the most offensive things said about black kids come out of the mouths of black people. The question is, are we honoring the humanity that exists in each other? And not just when it shows up in ways that make us comfortable. What I'm clear about, as much as I am that I'm a child of God, is that I can walk outside right now in this nice suit and still be shot in the same way that I could if I were wearing jeans that might have hung off my waist, right? The reality is that there are some spaces where we can't go in and buy a belt because we're assumed to not have money. But all of this is because my humanity shouldn't be conditioned upon how you perceive me, nor should theirs. So it's a literal question. How do you perceive the young people who move through the spaces that you encounter? Especially problematic when the boys appear to be bigger than what they actually are when we think about development. This was said on the previous panel. Brother Tony made this point very passionately. If you do nothing else, I'm going to offer up some solutions. We're going to take some notes in a second. But if you do nothing else, listen to the babies. So James, I'm happy for you guys to have extended this invitation for me. But next year, if it means that I don't get a chance to speak, give this slot to one of them. Far too often, adults come into rooms like this, focused on identifying solutions for young people, right? And what do? We sit down and we ask, what was it like when we were in school? Yeah, I remember this, I remember that. And then we come up with solutions that we think are designed to meet their needs rather than just asking them. One question, what do you need to feel safe, engaged, and supported? It's not that difficult. It's something that we aren't accustomed to doing. Why? Because we're told that we get these credentials and degrees and then we get to sit on fancy stages like this and talk to each other. That's nice, but what's meaningful in terms of moving through seemingly intractable solutions is to ask the experts themselves. So we have formed a partnership with Johnson Publishing Company, Ebony Magazine, to produce what we call AFAMAD Summits. We go around the country at post-secondary institutions like the Ohio State University. Next week, we will be at UNLV, as well as Loyola Marymount University. The only experts who get to sit on a stage under the White House seal are students themselves. The adults, the caring and concerned individuals who are elected or who otherwise have positions of influence, are invited to listen and to respond in meaningful ways to the solutions that the experts themselves have offered. All you gotta do is give them a platform. Sometimes it means you even give up your seat. You can find another one. You can stand up for a little bit. But when's the last time you actually listened to a young person? And not just listen to respond, or to tell them that you've experienced things that are harder, but really just listen. Sometimes our babies experience things on the way to and from school that the average adult would double over backwards trying to endure. I'm imploring all of you all to listen. I challenge you, in fact, to host a similar summit. If you go to our website, you can download a teach-in toolkit that will provide you with all of the tools to do it. There are no excuses. I'm gonna play this video in a second, but this is for anybody who in this room right now or who's listening will question whether or not young people are capable of engaging in the types of conversations that we are. Please play the video. Try it again. Maybe not. We tried clicking down toward the bottom of the image. Yep, no, that's not working. It's okay, we'll set it, technical difficulty. So I will share this video link later, but Marquise gave testimony in front of the Ferguson City Council right around the time of the Michael Brown's decision. And what you'll find when you listen to this is that Marquise asked a lot of questions that start with why. Why is it that police in my community don't look like me? Why is it that the teachers who are in my schools don't look like me? Why is it that the people who are business leaders in this community, they don't look like me, and when they leave to go home, they go home someplace else? There are a couple of moments where he says, what I mean by this is, and then he goes on to further explain it for anybody that thinks that young people are incapable of complex thoughts, it is a lie. You don't believe me? Go sit in a kindergarten circle. When kids are talking before they learn how to play the politics of respectability. They ask questions that some of y'all don't want to ask because you got paychecks and things to think about. Right? We have to listen to the babies. We have to listen to all of them in particular, right? So here's the thing, right? When brothers show up because they've been mentored and supported by the brothers who wrap their arms around these kings of excellence, and they also have a Queens of Excellence program, or Women's of Excellence, I call them kings and queens, right? But it's also important for us to listen to the babies that don't show up in the ways in which we want them to, right? Like, I was the child who would do backflips down a library stacks reading to you. I'm exceptional. Everybody ain't gonna do it, right? But the reality is that it's the ones who aren't gonna do that who need sometimes the most love, right? This is the young man. Is this gonna play? If not, I'm gonna have to tell the story too. Can you try this one, this video?
Which is physically grown by the ammonia of the fish. Nitrite, which turns into nitrate, and that is good for the fishes. It's good for the fish and the plants. And the reason why our water is green because of the algae, so we leave it green like this until it filters out. And the good thing about this system is it's a closed system, so all we have to do is feed it.
So Brandon is a young man that I met at Miami Northwestern High School, which is located right behind a project that is most notable for two things. One, producing rappers Trick Daddy and Trina, and also sending a significant number of black boys to Division I football teams. Some of them are at The Ohio State University, as well as to other teams around the country as well, right? So the reality is, for most black boys like Brandon, the only way to get out is to dribble balls or advance a ball down a field or to sing a song, right? That's not untrue for lots of communities where you find significant concentrations of kids as well as kids of color, right? This is a young man who was shot on his way to school earlier in this school year, right? But through an innovative partnership between FIU and JP Morgan Chase, had access to learning about agriculture and botany in ways that allowed him to literally turn a food forest into a food desert. That system that he's talking about is an aquaponic system that he built. Don't worry, I know some of y'all are gonna write down on Google aquaponics later. I had to do it as well, and I have a couple of fancy degrees. But he developed this system to figure out, his senior thesis project was whether or not this closed filtration system would produce crops at a faster rate than the farm he planted on the football field. Kids that most people look at as throwaway, disposable, right? The kids that are often thought of when people say silly things like college isn't for everyone. What I'm saying is that we have to change not only the way that we think about our babies, but how we talk about them and their potential too. And not just some of our babies, but all of our babies. Here are a few of the lessons that we've learned doing this work throughout the country. One is the importance of, again, reframing the narrative. James mentioned earlier the stat that people often cite incorrectly, which is that there are more black men in prison than in college, right? And I heard some of you applaud, so I think everybody here knows in part because the Curran Institute does a really good job with data. And it's that there right now are more than 700,000 black men on post-secondary institutions of higher education throughout this country than there are in prison, right? The footnote is that we are still disproportionately represented in prison. But the story that needs to be told is that in spite of all of that and the messages of enslavement and the consequences of racism and poverty, is that we still show up and show out, right? So rather than doing the thing where we focus on the one black boy that is likely to make it out of 87, let's talk about the collective number of them that get through successfully and what we need to do to bring more through that pipeline. We have to change the way that we have these conversations. And a part of that is allowing them to speak their own truth to power. The second thing we do is acknowledge that it said on the first panel in particular that learning starts at birth and the preparation for learning starts well before birth. This conversation can't start at kindergarten. It can't start at high school. It can't start with remediation in college. It has to start before a child is in utero. Why? Because that's the time when the foundation upon which all future learning and development will take place is formed. And we know things like a father recording himself reading to a child while he or she is in utero allows them to develop a connection that benefits both of them, right? Don't believe me? Ask anybody you know who's expecting a child. It's a man to record himself reading, and then watch the way that the baby, the infant, responds when she or he hears that person's voice. Relationships matter, even at that stage. The third thing is that this can't just be about a child's ability to do math or read a book. We have to attend to a child's social, emotional, and cognitive needs. I'm gonna spend a little bit of time here because when it comes to boys, we gloss over this way too quickly. We say silly things like, suck it up, boy. Our men don't do X, Y, or Z. Don't wear pink, don't cry, don't have emotions. It is all a lie. And this is especially important because black boys between the ages of 11 and 18 are committing suicides at 6 times the rate of their non-black male counterparts. I said 6. The rate has doubled in the last 2 decades. So while people just now are feeling some kind of way entering into this Black Lives Matter conversation, in a world where many of them have lost friends, too many to count, too many to name, we're also not talking about the selves that without us being intentional and asking them, how are you doing? And being willing to sit in the discomfort of not being able to explain everything away, that some of them are taking their own lives and or are otherwise struggling with not being whole, happy, and healthy. We can't just expect for them to walk to and from school without accounting for the things that they've endured on the way there. That has to be central to the work of supporting our babies. We have to leverage all tools to move full steam ahead. The one request I have of all adults is don't tell a child to put something down that they really seem to love, especially if it's because it makes you uncomfortable because you are unfamiliar with it, right? They listen to a song and you just don't get it. Ask them what's meaningful about it. TV shows and videos that just don't make sense to you, push them to articulate what it is that they find enjoyment in, and then scaffold them if you feel like they need to grow someplace else. But the worst thing you can do is kill a child's dream, or to otherwise push them away from something that might be connected to their passion. This is especially true around phones, video games, right? So the next time they're on the phone, they're using somebody's app, ask them if they know how to build their own. The next time they're playing somebody's video game, ask them if they have the tools to design their own. And now there are systems of support that will help them to be able to do that. Literacy is essential, not only for our babies, but for the adults in their lives who cannot read too. Show me a child who's struggling with literacy. I will promise you there's an adult in their life who is functionally illiterate. But we get too ashamed because people around us can't do the things that we can do. Instead of acknowledging that we are the descendants of people who risk their lives to learn how to read by candlelight and moonlight. And if I can read, everybody I know should be able to read. Some of this stuff doesn't require grants and interventions from a federal level, although that's important. We also need to celebrate and support post-secondary success for all. The first thing with regard to this is that the language has to change. It can't be you need to go to college, babies. You need to go through college, right? If there's one question, don't do that because I'm out of time. If there's one question, you ask everybody who you know that has a child, ask them, do you believe that their child can graduate from college? If they say no, ask them if you can hold the belief until they can hold it for themselves. Then do the work to help them get there. Let's go visit some schools. Let me break this down for you in ways that you can understand it as a real simple process. We just got to follow it. Help them fill out the FAFSA. This administration has simplified it. It's one page now. There are tools to help in this regard. There's a college scorecard, USED.gov. You can compare schools, figure out which one is the best fit. There are more than 7,500 post-secondary institutions around this country. I promise you there's one just right for that child. We got to hold each other accountable for doing this kind of work. That's the last piece, which is that this is village work, right? I started by saying, and I'll say thank you again, knowing that we're having a conversation with the congregation. So the last two things I'll ask of this. One, bring more people to the Army. We simply need more people to be doing this work. It bothers me that when we come into spaces like this, half the room is empty. If I was giving away tickets to a concert or a football game, it would be full. Imagine for a second how different our communities would be, how much stronger our country and our economy would be, socially and otherwise, if we spent half of the energy that we expend celebrating athletes and entertainers, celebrating our babies who participate in academic decathlons and do speech and debate, design robots, and literally try and figure out ways to change the world. Just half of it. We have to bring more people into this. While doing that, you also have to take care of yourselves. What I know is that it's difficult to be trying to do work that you sometimes look up and say, like, why am I trying to convince people to support babies? Right? I know that if our babies are supported, then everybody wins, right? We get more GDP to save the stuff that you expended trying to save them, allow them to innovate it. Everybody wins when our babies win, right? Stronger children, stronger community, stronger country. What I'm saying is I know this work is difficult. So as much as you are invested in supporting them, you have to be invested in supporting yourselves too. So share the burden. Push the people around you who don't know that they need to be engaged in this work in meaningful ways to do so, right? Remind them that there's a role for all of us to play. Again, not everybody should teach. Everybody should think about it, pray about it, find a way to support and affirm a teacher, an educator, formally or otherwise. I'm not just talking about those of us who have degrees and certifications. I'm talking about the teachers on the block too, right? The ones who offer safe passage and or otherwise speak life into our babies. I'm talking about all of them. Right? But if we're not going to do that, we can donate books, we can find ways to read, we can find ways to unlock passion and purpose. Right? It's homecoming time. I know y'all tailgate some serious around the Ohio State University and the other schools here. Take the babies too. Show them they can have fun and have something to look forward to. Give them the same incentives that work for us. But it first starts with us listening to them and honoring them. So again, I'm going to say thank you, not only for extending to me this invitation, but for ensuring that in the years that come, we don't do this again without ensuring that whatever we do, we make sure that they're at the center of it. Thank you. So I'm going to invite up some panelists to help us unpack some of this and hope that you guys will write down some questions that you might have. I will continue to highlight some federal resources as we continue to unpack this conversation. But just want everybody to know that the toolkit and a number of other resources are available on our website, www.ed.gov/AFAMEducation. First to the panel is going to be our young expert. He's going to keep everybody honest, C.J. Clardy. He's a student ambassador. He's a graduate of East High School in Youngstown, Ohio, and received a full ride scholarship to The Ohio State University from the Young Scholars Program. Give him a round of applause. Next is David James, superintendent of Akron Public Schools, who is creating career focus and strong dual enrollment programs to give APS high school students a head start on college. He's going to spend a lot of time talking to us about the importance of both being college and career ready. Give Mr. James a round of applause. Slide down one. Next is Hannah Powell, the executive director of KIPP Columbus, one of the highest gaining urban public schools in the country. She first came to KIPP as a school leader in 2008, and under her leadership, KIPP continues to see impressive academic growth. Give her a round of applause. Last but certainly not least is Dr. Romulus Durant, superintendent. TCPS proud is not just a catchphrase for this Toledo-born native. This is someone who not only talks the talk, but walks the walk. Anybody who asks questions should just shadow him for a day. Give Dr. Durant a round of applause. And I'm going to stand up here, but honoring what I said, I'm going to give this young king my seat so that he can keep everybody honest, too. So he can also have experience sitting on panels like this because he's going to do it for the rest of his life. That's you right there. All right. So tell me your name again, sir. Marvon Wiley. Y'all tell Marvon welcome. Our first question is going to go to Marvon and CJ. And I want to honor, before we do this, that CJ, when he graduates, is intending to use his skill and expertise to be a special education teacher. And so I want you, CJ, to start and talk a little bit about how it is that you decided to pursue education as a pathway, right, in a world where there are not that many of us, there are less than 2% of the workforce looks like us. Especially in special education or early education. So what compelled you to become a teacher? Why is it important for you as a black man to be an educator?
Well, first off, similar to what people have said previously, I was fortunate enough to have a teacher my senior year named Mr. Andrews. Excellent man. not just an excellent educator, but an excellent man. He was the first individual that taught me that education is a transformative experience, as opposed to just someone filling your knowledge with math. That's what he taught. He was an excellent mathematician. He taught at the Youngstown State University and East High School. He was master teacher. He loved his craft, and he was unapologetic about it. But personally, why I chose special education, I have a brother, and unfortunately, as we grew up, he was unlike me. I was very, very quiet, very reserved. He was very, very, very active, very loquacious, always wanted to know why, always interested in the why and how of his educational experience. And when I saw, as you know, a person who was very inquisitive, some of his teachers viewed as a disruption, a distraction. And unfortunately, he was placed in a special education program because he was disruptive in class. And that was something I saw that when it was time to treat him, they chose medication, much to my mother's chagrin. And the medication didn't help. It limited his outbursts. It limited his outbursts, but it transformed him into a very moody, very irritable young man. And these are things that I thought about and reflected on as I came to college, and I saw an opportunity to put myself in a position where I can not only advocate, but support and uplift many students in special education. When I came into my classes, I found that there are a lot of black and brown young men in special education classrooms, and a lot of them are in there for interpretations of their behavior, which is why I'm very interested in behavior interpretations. But I chose special ed specifically because I want to work with these students who are considered at risk. You know, there are students who are considered to be, you know, at the point where they may not be able to reach their student's ability level, and I see that as an opportunity to not put them in special ed to keep them there, but I'm sending you right back to class because we're gonna knock out this reading and we're gonna do this intervention, and you're gonna be right back with your peers where you need to be, not in this classroom, not away from your peers.
Hannah, I'm gonna ask you to pick up this theme of how we respond to at-risk kids and really to think about some critical connections around implicit bias and the practice of KIPP. But before we do that, Marvon, can you think about your favorite teacher, right? And the class that you most enjoyed. Describe that for us. What are the things that really, really good teachers do? And what happens in classrooms where you get really excited about learning?
The one teacher that excited me was Miss England, because she, at first I was low at the bottom of the chart, but then she helped me out.
What does that mean, you were low at the bottom of the chart?
That mean I wasn't doing good.
Who told you that? How did you know that?
Because I was acting bad.
Okay.
Disrespecting the teacher.
Okay.
Not following directions.
Okay, and then what happened?
So Miss England, she helped me out. She supported me.
How?
Like, she was like, there's nothing to be bad, because if you bad, there is no education for you.
Okay, so she gave you affirmation. She said positive things to you.
Yes.
What else did she do?
Yes, she spent time to like after school. She helped me out with my homework, and she was like telling me to do things like write down my homework so I don't forget to.
Sounds like she found ways to make you feel special and supported.
Yes.
That's it. All right. So. So I want to highlight, pull out and tease out a couple of things that I think were really important. So one is this idea that our children are really clear about how we perceive them, right? Sometimes the conversations that we think we're having amongst adults and that they're not receiving are the ones that they're leaning the most into, right? So we have to be clear and intentional about not only what we're saying, but how we are expressing our feelings and sometimes frustrations with our babies. And then the second is this idea of finding ways to show up in meaningful ways, right? It's not gonna look the same for all children, right? the things that work for marijuana, the things that are not going to work for CJ, the things that are not going to work for me. So it's really taking the time to learn about each student and figuring out how we meet their needs. So given all of that, Hannah, can you talk about two things? One is how you support your teachers and leaders with acknowledging and addressing implicit bias, supporting them and engaging with the students that CJ said would be perceived as at risk. And then more generally, what are the things that are most important or that you would otherwise attribute the success that you've seen to?
So, you know, first we have to believe that all kids can and will learn and be relentless about that. No excuses or no shortcuts. We also have to name that there are implicit biases. And implicit biases, thankfully, are not permanent. They're malleable. But you need to work through them, and we need to surface what those are, recognizing that there are some implicit biases that are more institutionalized in schools, half-day kindergarten, for example, and there's others that come into play that we have to overtly adjust in our schools. So most of the textbooks still, standard textbooks, are about people that look like me and experiences that are more reflective of mine. We also have situations where our teachers don't have the time to engage in conversations with our kids. So at KIPP, again, we believe that all kids can and will learn. We make time and space to address them. We place the success and well-being of kids above everything else. But we also don't take ourselves out of the equation as being part of the solution and having to address and understand our own implicit biases and how that plays out in the classroom and in other places.
Can you say a little bit more before we invite our superintendents into this conversation about how you might address some of these inequities, let's just call them? So you mentioned the lack of diversity in textbooks. How have you supplemented and or otherwise addressed that?
I mean, so many different ways. I mean, so one is being really clear about what we're purchasing as far, I mean, textbooks is one part of it. We need to have our kids surrounded with images and people who reflect who they are and their experiences as well. It also goes into who we hire. I mean, 5 years ago, 13% of the staff at KIPP in Columbus were people of color. Now they're 40, it's 40% and it's growing. Had to look at what are even our hiring biases. Wasn't intentional, but what are even implicit biases and how we're doing that, ensuring that we're having people of color in front of our kids, working with them, connecting with other partnerships around the community, Boys and Girls Club, for example, to ensure that our kids are having access to people and then near peer supports as an example. The way that we even greet our kids are explicit about creating non-negotiables about how the framework of our day honors and values our kids. You spoke, you know, that we need to honor each other's humanity. Our kids are greeted all the time. Our parents are called. We're following up. We're meeting on the weekends. We're meeting in the afternoons. We're meeting in the evenings. We're having things in the summer. So there's places and spaces to have the kind of conversation we need to support our kids.
So I appreciate that. And I am reading directly from the MBK report, the executive summary. There are four bullets. One is assuring healthy neighborhoods and supporting resilient families. Two is embracing a new narrative of resilience and high expectations. Three is challenging our implicit biases. And four is repairing the pipeline to educational success. And we've talked explicitly about at least two of those. We're going to talk more about family and community engagement. I'm hoping that you are already passing some questions. I'm going to open this up and Dr. Durant, as well as Superintendent James, I want you guys to address two of the bullets, which are one, embracing a new narrative of resilience and high expectation, as well as repairing the pipeline to educational success. So if both of you can speak to two things, one is, what's the work required around changing the way that we talk about our students and what is often referred to as the problem? And related to that, I'd like you, Superintendent James, to talk a little bit about your investments in career-focused programs. And then for you, if you would, Dr. Durant, talk about both young men and young women of excellence.
Well, so in terms of our focus is more on the career piece, in terms of regardless of whether you need a certificate, a two-year degree, four-year degree, we're really trying to reach kids at an earlier age to think about careers and give them exposure. We do a lot of that to help develop that spark in them by getting a lot of our partners in the community. For instance, this past summer, the makers of Purell Gojo, that company's located in Akron, As part of our Black Male Summit at the University of Akron, we had an internship where those students were paid the hourly rate of what the folks at Gojo make to learn more about careers there. At Summa Health System, Tom Malone, the CEO, hosted internships, and these were paid this summer for students so they can get a taste of that career. The other thing in terms of being more affirming to our young people, Akron was the recipient of a Community Connectors grant. And what we did is reached out to our faith-based community to bring in right now over 150 mentors, and it keeps growing into the district. And what we do is give them some cultural competency training and go through a whole training exercise so they really know how to approach the kids, because many of these folks, when they come in, may not have had the same experiences that our kids have had. And so we try to help bridge that gap and then bring those resources. We're really all about partnerships and looking in the community to bring those folks into our schools, you know, to provide that help.
Two related questions before we turn it over to Dr. Durant. How do you ensure that exposure doesn't become tracking? And then the second thing I'm channeling my inner Tykia Wright is, how do you ensure that these efforts are inclusive of all of our children?
Well, our focus isn't just on our African-American kids, in particular males, it's focused on all of our students. So what we do, though, is make sure that when it comes to our kids, that we're making sure that none of them are dropped, you know, or fall through the cracks, so that everyone is getting, you know, a similar opportunity or the same opportunity in order to be successful. And so when we have that training, we have it is a multicultural collection of faith-based organizations that bring their volunteers. And we just make sure that, you know, there are also with our Appalachian students, you know, whether there are Hmong students who come from Nepal, we have a huge variety of kids in our district. So we try to make sure that that training can help them notice those differences and address their needs.
Similarly, Dr. Durant, how do you push against the expectations that most people have of our kids? And then why the investment in the men and women of excellence?
From a parent alone, just as I express to the kids, that the power is not in the individual, but in the pack. In regard to, you know, when people say, Dr. Durant, can you come out and speak? Many times I say there's a request involved, and that means the students come with me. And we call it the stand your ground. So if I'm doing a keynote, they stand the ground right in front of me, and they do, and then we call that stand your ground. But in regard to the relationship, I'm about regard to relationships. I tell people that a child or a person don't care what you know until they know you care. And so when you're dealing with today's youth, and particular situation and coming from broken environments or households, at the end of the day, they want to know what you care about and how you care before they can develop a relationship with you. And so when you talk about our staff and how they engage our students much more differently, merely through relationships, in regard to talking about one of our assistant principals who I assigned as an advisor at the school, had his nose broken 3 times as an assistant principal.
Thank you.
3 times in 1 year, a year and a half time. Put him in as a Mo advisor, had a different perspective in dealing with the children, having a relationship with them. Now they call him dad. In regard to a different perception that you were no longer looking at me as an authority figure, but more importantly, a role model. So when you redirect me, it's because you care about me. The same way we operate as a system, meaning we have hall monitors. I don't need someone with a criminal justice degree to come in my hall to authority to direct kids. I need someone who has a coaching degree. Mm-hmm. I need someone who has a mentorship degree, who understands self-sacrifice. So ultimately, when I coach, I'm coaching more than just you on the basketball court or the football field. I'm coaching you in life. So when I say go to class, it's not about me as an authority for you to go to class. It's about me caring about you to be educated in the class. Different perception. So as a system, we have to organize in a way that peers and students and adults feel that you care about, opposed to, I have an authority, I'm the teacher, I'm the administrator, you go because I say. Because in today's class, there's a cultural class. The students or teachers or our youth aren't responding. In regards to, I care if you have a badge or a gun, I still will disrespect you, because at the end of the day, you haven't showed the respect towards me of caring. Those are the things that need to change. When we went into early childhood, we are one of few school districts in the state of Ohio in the country that have a Head Start grant. We are the grantee of Head Start. We measure according to 13 standards, both social emotion as well as cognitive. Out of the 13, the most glaring standard that had the most deviation from its peers, would build relationship with adults. For the three-year-olds, when I looked at the four-year-old, as well as the five-year-old, do you think that changes when they get into kindergarten? Do you think it changes when they become teenagers? So at the end of the day, we're generating a generational class if we do nothing to get involved on the front end, not only cognitive, but social-emotional, in regards to developing that understanding, in regards to senior citizens have a certain respect factor in the community. Well, that's lost, but it was lost then. The same way in regards to teachers or anyone else when it's in a society that has a social norm of expectation, again, those things happen in the early chapters of life. And so those are the things that helped us in early childhood.
Is the idea that young people challenging adults, is that new to this generation?
Repeat that again?
The idea that young people challenge adults or authority. I'm asking a leading question only because we all do that, right? By design, that's a part of being, of developing, right? But it strikes me interesting that now for a number of reasons, we have this conversation as if they're the first generation of young people to challenge authority, right? So question for you, Dr. Romulus, this came from the audience. After having, and again, let's be clear that while we might talk in absolutes, not all black people, especially black men, are created equal. So while some of us have experienced abandonment, parental withdrawal, verbal abuse, specific from black men, how do you get urban young black men to trust black male mentors?
Well, you know, I think the one thing is, particularly when we go into the schools, I don't just want the star player, just want the president of the student society. I want that young man who just came out of juvie, who just came out of the system, or the one who's expressing gang activities within the school, because ultimately those are the ones that ultimately can redirect and change the environment. When people say, when they look in, there was a marketing individual that asked me, and he said, Dr. Durant, what I see on your collar is the most innovative concept of branding I've seen in a long time. I said, you're seeing it now because you're out of touch what I see every day in Central City, in the streets, in the urban community. You see, I see teenagers tattooing street name and project housing on their neck and tattooing it on their forearm. I tell them that a residential situation is not their final destination. This branding of education can allow you to rise above all means. But again, having those conversations with our youth. So in essence, in regards to truly having that sense of building that relationship, but more importantly, in regards to a child, when they say they don't care what you know until they know you care, your presence is the most powerful than anything else. Meaning, I don't need your presence just during holiday season to hand me a gift. I need your presence throughout the week because your presence and mentorship is not an act of kindness, but an intervention of a deliverance of wicked ways and ways that I see on everyday activities. So again, in regards to we bring our mentorship together, I sit down with the advisors and ask, what is your commitment? What are you willing to sacrifice? So when I see a brother with a Black Lives Matter, I said, you know what, I need to see you on Monday. Come over to my office, because at the end of the day, I want you to show physically that your presence is saying Black Lives Matter. Yeah. Because I got a youth for you who really want to know you truly think that they matter in today's society. So again, giving opportunities, embracing the churches. I told people, the gentlemen that were here earlier, we call, because I'm from Toledo, so we're called Holy Toledo, right? I mean, we got churches on every corner, so we have an initiative calling Bring the Holy Back to Toledo. Meaning, we had this conversation of separation of church and state, which had went unclear and misunderstood. Now we have churches in our building from 7 to 7 at night, 7 days a week. Again, understand what you're doing in regard to operational efficiency and effectiveness. I can go into a congregation and leverage the talent within the congregation as a tithe and offerings into my school. Meaning, if you go to a certain church, I sit to the pastor and say, I need that physician over at these schools 1 day a week. When your pastor comes to you and says, hey, I need you at Jones Elementary, you best believe you're getting over there. Or you got a first-class trip to hell if you don't, right? Right?
Positive
so
accountability.
Again, in regards to that conversation of putting the faith-based community involved, but at the end of the day, saying your presence is more significant than any other time, but it needs to be on a much, much more consistent basis.
That's right, and from everybody as well. CJ, a question for you. I'm going to read the question, and then I'm going to shift the frame because far too often we have these conversations from a deficit perspective. And so the question is, what has been the biggest obstacle to your success as a black male? And I'm going to shift it, honoring the question, what's the biggest lesson that you've learned, or the most important lesson that you've learned?
It's interesting because I had wanted to comment on what was previously stated as well. I would say the thing that's really kind of been the biggest support. And in a way, answering the question that was posed is, I never felt like I had a lack of academic talent. I was very well educated, I believe, and I did score well in the ACT and tested into high classes when I came to Ohio State. The issue that I had was not education. It was more so about my moral education, how I am as a, how I view myself, not as an academic, but as a young man. And when I came to Ohio State, I had very little involvement from black men in my life when I was young, and I believe that that created some some challenges, I do. And when I came to Ohio State, specifically getting involved with the Bell Resource Center, I was able to connect with individuals like Todd Suddeth, Dr. Suddeth, Dr. Moore, and Ty Cornute as well. And not just, again, well, here's early arrival program, here's a couple days for you to talk to us, let's talk about what it means to be a black man. But no, I can come talk to Ty about, you know, the new Jordans that's coming out. I can go talk to, you know, Todd about how I think LeBron James is the best player in the world. You can't tell me anything different.
Kobe Bryant.
And I can have these conversations. I can have these conversations on a daily basis. You know, I can reach out to Dr. Moore, you know, as much as he's well-traveled as he is. If I need him, I know that he won't answer that phone call because it's me and he cares about me. And when I came to Ohio State, it was never, you know, oftentimes you think, well, you know, black men, they don't want mentors. They don't, you know, and that's a narrative I think is wrong. I think that we challenge the black men that we do meet when we come from these disadvantaged environments. Show me that you care, like you said previously. But unfortunately, you have to do double the work because it's almost like the students I teach. It's not that they don't believe they can read, it's that they've had so many failures. They've had so many of these adults fail them, unfortunately. I hate to use that word, but it's just being honest. And to come to a school like Ohio State and be surrounded by these men that are willing to go above and beyond to show me that you matter to me, you matter to this university, and more importantly, I want you to be the man that is one day going to matter to these other young students coming up. And that has been the most important, you know, help that I could ever get at Ohio State.
Not only was that profound, but you unpacked a lot in a very short amount of time. And I want to honor not only that you clearly are reflective, but have been committed to doing this work, right, in some meaningful ways. And I want to push because I think you, in a much more elegant way, said the question that I asked you guys to think about earlier, which is, are we worthy of our children, right? What CJ said was, show me that you care. And how many times have you asked anybody in your life, romantic or otherwise, the very same thing? Show me that you care. So why is it that when our babies demand that of us, we look at them as if there's something wrong, as if we don't owe them, right? So Brother Romulus has reported a demonstration of the fact that we are going to be there consistently, not just in the moments in which they show up in the ways in which we want or expect for them to, but in the moments in which they fail, like all of us do, right? So the question, again, I think in another way to push it back to all of you is, how are you showing the children in this community that you care, right? Being here today is a demonstration of that. What does that look like when we leave? Our young expert, Marvon, question for you. What needs to change about school, right? When you think about like the worst things there are your friends who don't go to school, who aren't as engaged as you are, what things need to change so that more of us go to school and are excited about learning?
There are two things. First is that too many kids is acting bad and they disrespecting Martin Luther King. And some kids wearing Dr. Grant property.
You gotta take your time, brother.
Wearing Dr. Grant items and they acting bad. And they disrespecting Dr. Grant items too.
So let's unpack this for a second. Hold on, y'all. When you say they're being disrespectful and they're being bad, what does that look like? And why do you think they're doing that?
They just trying to impress more kids. They trying to be the class clown.
Okay, because that's what's celebrated. That's what people get props for. You get to be cool if you acting disrespectful.
No. Not in our school.
Not at your school. So I hear you say that if you create cultures where you celebrate excellence and challenge people to be positive and then hold them accountable, all that foolish stuff goes away.
Yes.
Right, boom. You got your tangible recommendation. What's the second thing that needs to change?
That there are kids that's not they think they are not paying attention in class. They're not coming in on time, and they're disrespecting teachers and the staff.
Okay, so again, not engaged. And I'm pushing a little bit to say they're probably not engaged because it's maybe not relevant to them. They find it a little boring and easy, or otherwise asking, why do I need to learn the value of these angles in this triangle I'm never going to encounter in my grown life? And I'm trying to figure out how to survive and be healthy when I live in a food desert, right? How do we find ways to meet them where they are, right? To engage them in ways that are meaningful, but are also connected to the things that we are expecting of them in this global 21st century economy. I'm also gonna pause and just say, great job, right? You were the only one that didn't expect to be up on here, and you were speaking a whole lot of truth to power.
There's one more thing.
Go ahead. See, when they get comfortable, they start showing out. Go ahead, sir. Can y'all sit back? You see his posture too? Go ahead, sir.
That some people just talk about lots of people, and they bully kids, and they shouldn't be doing that. And they talk behind the teacher's back when she look away.
So significant points. I'm glad you pushed me on honoring this. Too many of our kids don't feel safe. In class, walking to and from classrooms, on the way to and from school, and it's something that we don't talk enough about, right? For a couple of reasons. One, some of us think that that's a rite of passage. Go ahead, get roughed up. You go and figure it out. You'll be all right, right? And then others of us are not sensitive enough to the ways that bullying impacts our kids' ability to show up, pay attention, and learn, right? So there's a lot of data around this, around the importance of students feeling safe, engaged, and supported. And there's lots of tools, including restorative justice, right, as well as PBIS that everybody should be familiar with to make sure that that is not an issue. The other thing we need to be sensitive to is that too many of our children are engaging in conversations and have communities that are virtual. Right, and because we're not on Twitter, we're not on Snapchat, we say let them do it for the Vine. We don't know what's going on. He's laughing because he know I'm telling the truth. Right, but we need to be in those spaces. Right, African American people in particular are overrepresented in social media. 90% of Americans have more than 2 social media profiles. I know all of y'all are on the Facebook, as my mother calls it. That's not where they are. Right. We need to go to where they are and ensure that they feel safe no matter where we are. That was a good one, brother. That was a good one. Hannah, question for you. Someone would like for you to tell us a story about developing character in students and why that's important from a developmental perspective.
So at KIPP, we say 49% academics, 51% character. And our goal and our mission is to develop the knowledge, skills, and character necessary for success in college and life. That we have high expectations for our kids because we value them so much. To a story that's quite recent. On Wednesday afternoon, I got an email from our KIPP Through College director at KIPP. We're just a middle school now in Columbus. We have 2 full-time staff members who just support our alumni. So we have freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors throughout Columbus right now in high school. That one of our alumni, we just learned, had dropped out and wanted to know if she could get him to KIPP, would I meet with him that night? The answer is obviously yes, of course. His name is Daquan, and I've gotten the opportunity to know Daquan since he was 10. At our school, he started in the 5th grade and is now a senior. Daquan's cousin, an all too familiar story, was gunned down just over a month and a half ago on the east side, and turned 18, and he made a choice to stop going to school. When he came to my office, you know, and just as you said, you gotta listen, right, and seek to understand before being understood. It wasn't, what are you doing? Why are you doing? You've got to get back in school. This is not the option. 100% of us are going to go to and through. It was not the time. The question was, what do you need? What do you need? And he didn't, in some ways, know how to answer that at the moment. So we just paused and got comfortable being uncomfortable in the silence of that room. So I switched it to, what do you want? The answer was, well, I want to have some money, and I want a car. And then he said, and I want to be in school. I said, all right, let's start with the last one. That's what you want. That's what we're going to do. We're going to get into school. We continued to talk, and the conversation went a couple of different ways. And we talked more about the situation and how he was having a really hard time processing what was going on. And before the conversation was over, I was getting ready to get up, and he said, I want something else. So what do you want? He said, I want to find my purpose again. So we're going to find that too. And we're going to start with getting enrolled, and on Monday he starts back to school. So to that piece of, it was in Daquan, and by the way, after he left my office, he went down with his old teacher, who's the assistant coach of the basketball team, and introduced Daquan to all of the young men at our school and said, this is Daquan. Daquan was on the first basketball team at KIPP. Daquan was the fifth grader that won the first basketball game ever at KIPP, and he's a senior. You know, and the kids look at him like, man. You know, and Daquan starts to get some of, it's not immediate. It isn't one night, one conversation, and this is going to somehow, no, there's a whole lot to unpack and to continue to be there. But the character piece is that you matter, and you're valuable, and you're worthy, and we're with you all the way, no matter what. Whether it's good, it's bad, it is what it is. You have us, and we're here. And by the way, it's not KIPP, it's you. And you have everything inside of you to be exactly who it is that you want to be, and we're going to have those high expectations and the supports that are necessary to help you get to where you need to go.
Awesome, I appreciate that. And I saw CJ's head nodding along the way. Did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I would just like to say that it's so important. Unfortunately, you have a lot of students, first generation, they think that the pinnacle is their value, their contribution to society is doctor, lawyer, doctor, lawyer, doctor, lawyer. That's what grandma says, that's what, you know, maybe mom, who doesn't really know a lot about school, says, maybe that's what dad says. Again, they want what's best for you. And unfortunately, sometimes you bring the hopes and aspirations of an entire community with you when you come to school from a small place like Youngstown, where no one goes to college. It's a big deal, it's important. And it's important also to be able to have those conversations with people across various career fields and, you know, understand that my place does not necessarily have to be commutarist, the MD, or, you know, the lawyer, or the, you know, high-ranking political figure, or, you know, the pastor. I can approach my place, and I can find my opportunity to contribute in just a variety of settings and a variety of different ways. It doesn't just stop at those kind of things where we, again, you know, the adults tell us, you have this job, you know, they don't tell us in specifics, but they say without saying, you know, we expect this of you. And it, again, is finding ways and opportunities to explain to these students that excellence does not come in one shape and size, and that we can continue to push that narrative to them until they accept it and they, you know, in their hearts, and they teach that to their other students.
So again, let's unpack some of this brilliance, right? And I heard some verbal affirmations of a few things that were said. One, he talked about the burden of carrying his community with them to college, right, which is all too familiar for so many first-generation students of anybody's community, right? And I talked a little bit earlier on during my presentation about what we now popularly celebrate as resilience and grit, except far too often we don't acknowledge the work required to get there, right? There's a lot of physical, psychological, emotional energy that this young man continues to expend thinking through and caring about the messages that have been sent to school with him. Right. The second thing is this, the importance of passion. How many times do we send black kids to school to get a job? And a job that makes sense to us. Right? He talked about doctor, lawyer. Everybody get that? Folks that don't even have degrees, ain't been to a college campus. They can make sense of that. Rather than saying to our babies, go do that what you were purposed to do, what you were most passionate about, and I will be here to celebrate you as you figure it out. Right, and the reality is that too many of our babies that look like me, who come from our communities, don't get to have the purpose conversation. We just have the math conversation, right? And both are important. Dr. Durant, what's the most important step to ending the school-to-prison pipeline, or what some might call the cradle-to-prison pipeline, looking at stats?
And that's just what I was about to say in regards to. Because I sit on forum when they talk about the schools to prison, and I say let's back it up in regard to the cradle to prison pipeline. I said in regard to, and we haven't had enough conversation about early childhood development. So in regard to, I said I went over to Germany to study their system, and they're hanging their hat on success, revitalization of their country based on universal preschool. Biggest thing that they think is going to have the most impact in their country.
But the more important in regard to having a conversation in the local community in regard to understanding the importance between a child's birth to 5 years of age. You know, and taking them through that scenario and understanding that when you divine this building, you have a blueprint. If I want that door there, I need to put it in the blueprint. If I want these lights there, I need to put it in the blueprint. Well, guess what? These babies are born with the minds that are the blueprint of their reality. Meaning, if I want certain things, I have to put it in the blueprint. But understand in regard to you only have a window of time before the brain starts slowing down and it's developed. I say the most informative years are between birth to three, where the brain is most developing in regard to what it's developing to become. By the time they're 4 years of age, that child has already developed a personality as well as 80% of their brain is developed. Meaning some of you have four-year-old teenagers walking around your house right now. But at the same time, at 5 years of age, they're already at 90%. And 6 years of age, 95% of the blueprint is already laid out. That's when schools get them in kindergarten. But when we start talking about now the social emotions, when I talk about the relationships with adults, is that when you talk about that pipeline in regard to not only having a cognitive ability, but at the same time having a relationship to build with adults as well as peers, is also the impact. So when you talk about young men of excellence and young women of excellence, it's about peer-to-peer relationships. When this young man talks about not at our school because there's an accountability system among the peers, meaning that doesn't go on at King Academy for Boys. At the same time, in regard to some of our other high schools, you talk to some of the kids that when a child is being escorted to the door for a hall monitor, a MO member who's walking by is to pull that child and say, ma'am, may I speak to this young man? And then begin to talk about the expectation of excellence within this group. And we send the child right back to class. The staff has accepted that because they understand that peer-to-peer dynamic of encouragement has went much further for that child's success to be in that room. But again, the conversation of being at early childhood education is that the emphasis put there, because from K to 3, a child learned to read. From 3 to 12, they read to learn. If the process of learning to read is slowed, the process of reading to learn is even slowed. Kids read their way into college, they write their way out of college. Understanding reading and writing is indicative of each other. You can't read, you're gonna struggle writing. Again, you want weight on the back end of graduation, as well as careers, you got to put more weight on the front end. Going universal preschools in your community to make sure that every child has a civic responsibility. They start off at 6 years of age with the blueprint as everyone else's.
Hannah, you talked earlier about the role, about the role of parents and families in supporting the work that happens in the school. And I want to just open this up to acknowledge that what you spoke about, Brother Durant, is village work, right? Like, it requires a lot of people to support the laying of the foundation of the blueprint and then the building upon it. Can you, Hannah, start, and then we'll open it up, talk about the role of parents and families and how it is that you ensure that parents and families feel engaged and not just invited after the table has been set to the comment made on the previous panel?
Yeah, so I don't think there's ever enough work done here, and it's not, oh, we do it and we do it really well. I think we're constantly trying to get better at it. But it's not about rhetoric, it's about creating real change with them, and we've, as a school, made very sacred promises and need to continue to really build trust. How do we do that? So before a kid comes to KIPP, we have a meeting with them in the home. So just to go over what you can expect from us first and what we're doing, and thank you for choosing to come to our school. Thank you for trusting us with your children. These are some of the things that we want to expect also from you and start building that partnership. We don't have, for example, we don't have a formal PTA, if you will, that's called the village to that. And we have community nights every month. There are other ways that they though are involved besides these kind of community things that we do. So we call them every day. If their child is not here, we let them know that they're not here. Is there something that we can do? They're getting daily, if not hourly, connection to their kid's achievement, which is what they really want to know. How are my kids doing? And what can I do to help? We engage other community partners to try to build build those relationships with our families. Our teachers, again, are there. Our family conferences, many conferences you'll find happen from maybe 8 to 3 in other schools. Ours are from 8 to 8. If you can't come during that time, we'll meet you someplace else. So I'm just giving you examples of, it's much more than saying, hey, please be involved, or I want you to ask your child, please ask your child, how did your school day go? Can you, here's some tips on how to do that. What do you want from us? What can we do to be better? Getting feedback and then actually being responsive to that. Admitting that we don't have all the answers, and we don't have it all right, and we're willing to grow and be humble in that. I think all of that kind of contributes to a culture where we're in this together. And community partnerships are a big part of that too, again, at KIPP, in ensuring that we're delivering on the promises that we've made to our families. But there are, you know, there are number one with their kids, the reason why we're here, there are stakeholders, and we work really hard to build relationships with them.
Yep, as a card-carrying member of the Mama's Boys Club, I wanna shout out all the parents in the audience. Thank you for being a child's first and most important educators. Superintendents James or Durant, would you like to respond as well, the importance of and our strategies to ensure meaningful parent, family, and community engagement?
Sure. You know, we have a big partnership with LeBron James and his foundation, and so over 3,500 of our kids are in his Wheels for Education, I promise. And one of the things that LeBron has really focused on is this whole thing about we are family. So in his messages to our kids, both individually and the opportunities that he's providing for them along with his foundation, and their parents, you know, reaching out to the parents. We this year had with Project Learn, for some of the parents of the kids who didn't have a high school diploma, he's reached out with those partners to bring them all together. And that's really helping a segment of our population. And on our side of that relationship, we're developing more parents to be mentors to other parents and providing them the training so they understand what our situation is and some of the needs, and then going out in the community and helping them.
I imagine not much happens anywhere within the borders of the state that involve LeBron James that not everybody is aware of. But for anyone who missed it, just this week, the First Lady joined LeBron James here to talk about the Make Room Initiative, right, which is in part ensuring that we have these conversations and leverage resources to ensure that all that we're talking about is made real for all of our children. Two additional resources that I would highlight in this regard to support parent, family, community engagement are, one, a set of rights. The U.S. Department of Education identified a set of rights, four things that all parents and families should expect from their schools and school systems, including access to high-quality early care and education, as well as meaningful K-12 opportunities to learn, as well as affordable post-secondary opportunities. There are also a set of questions that have been developed by NCLR, UNCF, and a couple of other national organizations that provide parents with questions that they can ask to ensure that those goals are made meaningful. So I encourage you not only to download those, but to tell me if there are gaps, if there are things that are missing, right, from the perspective of the communities that you work for. If there are ways that we can enhance those tools, let us know so that we can do that. Dr. Durant, you want to get on that one as well, parent family engagement?
Mainly in regards to the partnerships that we've had, one of the things that we've done in Toledo is that we worked with the Boys and Girls Club and the YMCA to shut down a silo location and built them to the bricks and board of our building. Meaning they no longer have a Boys and Girls Club. It sits on the corner of Adams and Jefferson. That building is closed down. Now we built and redesigned some of the buildings and renovation, and when we built new buildings, they were built within that project. Meaning that now efficiencies and effectiveness has increased, as well in regards to, we're the expert in education, but at the end of the day, addressing communities from recreation as well as some activities and parental involvement, they were providing a whole wealth of activity for that. So now their efficiencies have increased in regard to now no longer paying rent, lease, utilities, and capital costs. They're within our facility. At the same time, their participation has skyrocketed, not only parental involvement, but student involvement, because the days of kids going home, getting on bicycles with neighborhood friends and coming back to the club no longer exist. So when they come on down, they go straight to the activities. When mom and dad are done with work, they come right into the location in regards to what the kids are doing with tutorials or whatever that may be. But ultimately, at the end of the day, we provide wraparound services no different than Harlem Children's Zone does, right there at the location where you're having wraparound services and meeting all the child's needs along with the home needs. Because if you don't do interventions at the home, you are always managing the problem. And so getting them involved heavily and providing opportunities outside of school, if you're daunted about school, but you're not daunted about the Boys and Girls Club or the YMCA, will partnership help to make that bridge between the two?
We're going to land this plane in short order. Is there a hashtag that we're using for the conference such that if people still have questions, they can? It's on the... Okay, so everybody use the hashtag if you still have questions. Want to make sure that we're inviting others into this conversation and we can continue it after our hard stop at 1:15. This goes to our experts, CJ and then Marvon. I'm going to read the question. How do I break through through a tough exterior, specifically of a 9-year-old boy who does not yet know his own power? My words, not theirs. I keep encouraging him. I tell him that he can. At one point, Hannah, I want you to answer this part of the question. His mom won't come in for a conference. Should I offer to go to the home? Should I offer a home visit? But to CJ and to Marvon, what does a caring adult say to us when we don't yet know our power?
I think that it's incredibly important. Like a lot of times you talk to your mom, dad, parents, administrators, they say, you know, you go to college and you get this transformative experience, but you also get an occupation. I think that one of the things that is not stressed enough at an early age, especially when you're talking about students who come from, you know, kind of disadvantaged backgrounds, they don't see the value. They don't understand, you know, you live in a world where you're living, you know, you have the privilege of looking at your life from a year-long standpoint of you can make these kind of plans to lead to these steps and get to these major goals. Some of these students, they're thinking about week to week. They're thinking about day to day. They're thinking about what they're going to eat tonight, you know, what they're going to eat tomorrow. You know, do they have enough, you know, money to ride the bus to get to school? Things that don't correlate with this long-term investment of my educational experience. So I would just like to harken back to my teacher who also taught at Youngstown State University. He would really empowered us to understand that your value as a person who digests education is that you can immediately apply it. I mean, and I don't mean at the end of the year when we do this project. Specifically, when I was in high school, we did a thing where you had to solve a calculus problem. And what it was is that we set up the situation where you were a pilot and everyone in the class was a passenger. And my teacher was kind of like the flight attendant. And the thing was is that you have to solve this math problem quick enough so that you can alter our trajectory so that we don't crash. And it sounds funny, but he's like, look, this is really what these people do. This is really what this education, you know, transforms into. So it's not just, you know, oh man, I didn't get this derivative right, or oh man, I didn't get this problem right. It's understanding that this is actually going to translate into me being able to turn this into a profession that, you know, can help me, can help my family. But these students are just so focused on, what can I do to help myself, can help my mom, help my brother, help whoever? And a lot of times they see education and they don't see that bridge is going to connect them to those resources that they need, you know, to help their peers and their friends. And unfortunately, you know, again, we get this message where you just have to invest, and they just simply don't believe in investing. And that's, you know, something that I think can be really worked on if you empower the student to very early on understand that this, you know, ABC 123, you know, mumbo jumbo, it's going to translate almost immediately to what you can do to help now, you know, not 5 years, not 10 years, not when you get older, right now. And I think that's the most important thing that you can do to get through to students who just don't necessarily see that bridge.
I appreciate that. And you also responded to one of the questions, which is how we place more emphasis on the substance of education rather than just the brick and mortar. And I hear you saying make it relevant. What's your response to that? What does somebody say to a brother who doesn't yet know that he's powerful?
That, like, you can do it. Just go ahead and try, because if you don't do it, you wouldn't know.
You just have to stay consistent. Is Kevion Thornton, where are you? Kevion, can you stand up and ask your question? I want to make sure I got it right. You have to use your teacher, your basketball court voice, or your teacher voice. Come on, come closer. How can what? Don't get quieter as you get closer. Use the same voice. Scholarship dollars are the rate at which they graduate, the rate at which we graduate. Okay, his question is, how can we increase the rate at which African-Americans graduate from college? Who wants to take that one?
Can I just say really quick, I work, in addition to my other position, I work in the office of giving out scholarships to students in different capacities within ODI in previous years. And I would love to say that a lot of times the students just aren't simply aware that there's money out there. They're often fed this narrative that there is, you know, a slim amount of money and slim amount of opportunities. And it's very important from the administrative model that, you know, I've talked to friends at Ohio State about money that they were actually able to apply for that following year that was able to keep them in school that they just didn't know about. And that's not necessarily something where they didn't get the email or something, but it's just opportunities where they have to be aware that this funding is out there, and more so than just one big blanket email that gets sent to everyone. It really has to be driven home that, hey, these are opportunities that you can take advantage of, you know, next semester. I would say that's incredibly important.
So three things, and I have one final question for the panel. I'm going to respond to your thing directly. One is we have to change the way that we talk about college, right? So in the Black community in particular, we still imagine that college is only a four-year institution like the Ohio State University, and we make people who are to assume paths that look very different, like a two-year degree, certificate, or institution as a pathway, we make them feel inferior, right? So there are simply too many of us that don't go to college because we don't know that we can go. Right, because we haven't been told that we have the skills that we need to be successful, and because we live in spaces where we allow other people's shame, right, to make us think that we shouldn't pursue our dreams. So that's one. The second thing is, to CJ's point, we leave a lot of money on the table. Every year there are hundreds of thousands of dollars that are purposed to pay for you guys to go to school that nobody applies for or uses. We have to, in the same way that we prepare for and apply to college early, we need to do the same thing for financial opportunities, right? We also have to do a better job of acknowledging that when we are in spaces like this, we need to ask people like this to sow into our future, right? To write checks so that we can go to college as well, right? And then the third thing is just being financially thoughtful, right? We still make too many decisions based on our finances that are not aligned with what some of our goals are. So to support all of that and changing it, we have a toolkit, a first-generation college toolkit that you can download on our website, right, that we hope will help you take some of those meaningful steps early so you have as much money as you need to go to whatever school you desire to go to that's just right for you. I'll make sure that we send it to you so that all of your babies get it. Last question to the panel. We spent a lot of time talking about not only problems but solutions. What's your ask? What is your call to action? What's the one thing that you want everybody in this room to do so that the next time we come here to have this conversation, it'll be very different? We'll start with you and work our way down.
I think my one ask is to get involved. I could say I run a mentorship group for men as well as women. I started the women probably a year and a half. But one thing that I found that was significantly different is that men and I started the women's group, and when you start looking for advisors and committed advisors, women were coming from out of everywhere. I mean, I have five, possibly three to five advisors per chapter. But when I go to the men's group, you hear me? When I go to the men's group and look for that commitment, you start to see some of the signs that we see in family frictions and other things that I can't get them as much as I could in regard to the women. So in regard to looking for commitments, in regard to your male in this room to get involved within the schools, I have to give a plug for United Way in regard to United Way and African American Initiative. They run a program called Real Men Read. We put this in the schools. And what we recruit is African-American business people, clergymen, those who are affluent or have particular statuses in their industry. We bring them to read to preschool, kindergarten, and first graders. They come every week committed to read for an hour. After the first 2 weeks, remember, these gentlemen are coming in business attire. What did you think those kindergartners started doing when their guy was coming on third day? What do you think they did when they came to school? They was in a tie. Right? The mentors say, oh, you got a tie on today. And when the principal asked, he said, well, my mentor's coming today. So again, the power of your presence is bigger than what you know, because what the child sees is what they imagine in their mind. I tell the kids in regards to when they ask about, I'm not sure what I want to do, and I say, what's your passion? And I resort in regard to Superintendent James and his area. I say, whatever it is, you should feel like you are LeBron James of what you do. Meaning he can own that basketball court, but he can't own a classroom like you as a teacher. He can own a basketball court, but he can't own a medical facility like you as a nurse or a doctor. And at the end of the day, let us show you how this works. And so in regard to talking about career readiness and things that we're doing in the district, is that by the fifth grade and going into the sixth grade, we use Naviance as a career identifier, as well as showing here all the pathways according to your strengths. But I got to make sure I take care of things on the front end for preschool, so ultimately I give you a variety opposed to limitations. And then when parent-teacher conference comes, guess what? It's more than just about grades. Mom and dad, let's talk about what his assessment has shown. Here are the career pathways. Here are all the programs. We have over 36 career tech in our district. Here are the ones that align to your child's strengths. We will not only give him or her a field trip, but we do open houses for these locations. You need to see those.
Seventh and eighth grade, we've given this child now a pathway, because seventh and eighth grade, we have early high school opportunity, meaning you could take high school courses at seventh and eighth, we will bus you over for the last period of the day. So they start building up to 9 to 12 credit towards graduation. Ninth and 10th grade, what do you think they're finishing up on? So what do you think they're doing 11th to 12th grade? Post-secondary. If I've identified your passion, I could ultimately provide a pathway to get you not only a diploma in one hand, a degree in the other hand, through articulation with the community college as well as the four-year colleges, all within the comfort zone of high school. So right now, we've already developed 5 associate pathways within our career tech. You get a business degree, an associate. Applied science and engineering with an associate. You could get an associate of art with an associate. Again, all these different pathways and developing more articulation, but ultimately when that child's comfortable within their setting, then begin to start exploring off to different campuses. But we bring campus to them, allow them to have a success and a win under their belt to say, I have an associate degree, their probability going on for a bachelor's is even greater.
Give Dr. Durant a round of applause. Hannah, call to action.
In addition to engagement, which certainly came up, I already asked Demetrius to apply to teach at KIPP next year, so I hope that he will. And maybe next year at this time, we'll be here with a KIPPster when you're at our school teaching special education to our kids who absolutely need you.
Give Hannah Powell a round of applause. Superintendent James.
Thanks a lot, Romulus. Pretty much ditto what he said. But the other thing is, like our director of our local project grad says about our kids, they don't know what they don't know. And I need many of you, and it's not so much to tutor kids, but it's to give them the insight to what the real world is out there and how they can make the connections and how you can tell them the stories so they can be successful. So I need more of you in our schools.
Sorry, I'm taking it back just for one quick
second. Go for it.
It's the other piece is that it's the kids are ours, every single one of them. And so I think just moving more boldly, even in our community, and continuing the way that so many people are, United Way and others, and leading the charge. But the kids are ours, every single one of them. It's not about what type of school, the adult politics that it get into this, the agenda. Like those of us that are in our schools every day and those of you who are too, it doesn't matter. And our kids, and we're failing our kids and need to do something dramatically different to make transformational life outcomes for them. So if we as a community can continue to come together in very bold ways, it's not about us, it's about them, about all of them, we'll see change in our community happen.
Give both David and Hannah another round of applause. CJ, what's your call to action?
If I could ask one thing, it would be that I would continue to challenge everyone in the room to continue to change your perception of a successful black man. Because how you view a successful black man is, again, how you want to prepare the young students. You know, a successful black man, you know, may not be in a fraternity. A successful black man, you know, may not be.
If he is, he's a Kappa.
A successful black man may not, like my teacher, Mr. Andrews, was gay, and I respected him, that portion of his identity, but I continued to allow him to be a successful, I didn't view him, oh, he a cornball. He was still a successful black man. You know, again, you know, you don't have to necessarily be married. Again, we talk about things in church. You can be a Buddhist and be a successful black man. And those have been my experiences in both the BRC, working with incoming freshmen, as well as in the schools, is that these students, these young, you know, black, these boys that are going to become men, you know, they need proper guidance, and that guidance does not have to look all the same. You can't blanket their curriculum. You can't blanket their development. You have to continue to adjust your educational structures for that budding developmental young boy that will be the next, you know, generation of successful black men.
I think Hannah and I might have to arm wrestle on who's going to hire you first. CJ, give him a round of applause. Y'all can do better than that. This boy is speaking truth to power up here. All right, you get the last word, young king. What do you need these people to do differently?
To encourage more black people, black children, and to listen to little kids.
Period, full stop. That's important. Stand up. So I want to honor again, that's for you. So I want to be clear that this was as much for him as it was for y'all, right? Yeah, y'all can come on. Y'all come in the lineup. Y'all come. Is that what y'all gonna do? Come on, y'all can do the same. Y'all can come stand with him, because he was the least prepared technically, but still was able to show up. You got something to say, sir? All right, hold on. I'm gonna get out your way in a second. But I encourage all of you to provide space for our babies in the way in which we did, for him to show up and demonstrate how brilliant he was. And if there's one thing that I would ask of each of you is to answer the question that I asked at the beginning, which is, are you worthy of our children? Right? Our First Lady Michelle Obama showed a screening of a film called The Inevitable Defeat of Mr. and Pete. It's a Lionsgate film, but it's really the story of them. Young misters who were often told to take care of the worlds around them without people acknowledging that sometimes they don't have the support they need. Right? So Mr. is a young black boy who, when we meet him, is told he's not smart enough to go to the next grade, but who is then left to his own devices because his mother, who's a drug addicted prostitute, gets arrested. And he's left to fend for himself in the summer in the New York City project. And one of the most meaningful moments of the film for me is when Mr.'s in the back of a social service car, and he breaks down and cries for the first time. And he says to this man, I don't think I can do this on my own. And the reality is that none of us should be expected to. I don't know a single person who counts him or herself successful that can claim that they've done it on their own. But some of us forget that some of our babies don't have stable places to sleep, don't have a constant love and affirmation of an adult who's going to ensure they know that somebody's going to be with them when they make these mistakes. And if we can change one thing, we can change that reality, right? It should not be the case in our country that a single child wakes up questioning whether or not somebody values them, sees them, or loves them. So my ask is for you to be mindful of all of our babies, right? Not just the ones that show up in the spaces where we expect for them to, but the ones who have been told or have otherwise received messages that say that they don't belong there. Just look out for our babies. Ensure that the answer to the question, are we worthy of them, is yes, without equivocation. Thank you again. Know that you have partners in the White House who are looking and excited to continue to support your work. Hear me when I say thank you, thank you, thank you. Good job. Yes, go for it. You can do whatever you want, young king.